Welcome, this is Information Service Engineering, lecture number 12, Basic Machine Learning, part 3. This is going to be the very last section of the machine learning section of this lecture. So this will be now on knowledge graph embeddings. If you have seen the last lecture and the notebook for the last lecture, you are already familiar with word embeddings. And now we want to extend this concept of embeddings also to knowledge graphs. Okay, so how can we do that? So you remember word embeddings? For word embeddings, words with a similar meaning are mapped to close vectors in a vector space. So if the meaning of the words is similar, their vectors also will be near each other, will be similar to each other. Now, how can we map this concept also to knowledge graphs? When are two nodes or two entities semantically similar? Think in terms of knowledge graphs. They might be similar if they are described by the same or then by similar facts. Simple example, so let's take carbon dioxide and water. Both of them are greenhouse gases, which means they share a property, so there must be some kind of similarity. Or take Albert Einstein and Stephen Hawking. Both have been physicists, so also they are similar. The question now is Stephen Hawking more similar to Albert Einstein or more similar to carbon dioxide? So there is a way to find this out. So simply look at the graph structure. So these are, of course, imaginary graph structures, showing on the one hand side the greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide or water vapor, and on the other side, the two physicists, Stephen Hawking and Albert Einstein. So if we look at the first two, at the greenhouse gases, we see here that they share a number of properties. So they share also that both are a gas, both are a chemical compound. So this is already quite nice. They might also have, let's say, some differences. So they are not exactly identical. However, they have something like a similar context. And this is exactly the same for our physicists. So both of them are persons. Both of them are physicists. And of course, there are also differences. So Albert Einstein was born in another city than, for example, Stephen Hawking. However, you see, we can construct also here from the given context, you know, vectors. So this is exactly the same principle as you already know from word vectors, where we said you shall know a word by the company it keeps. You can also say you shall know a node by the company it keeps, which means which is the context of the node, the structural context. So similar nodes can be identified by having the same similar neighborhood, which means the same context. So this is again our old and major principle of distributional semantics. Okay, and then we come up with something like graph embedding. So we are transforming the graph representation into a vector space representation. So we will find an embedding of nodes in a low dimensional vector space, meaning producing dense vectors, so that similar nodes in the graph have vector embeddings that are close together. However, this holds for any kind of graph. Knowledge graphs are a special kind of graph, so we have a bit more restrictions and semantics to encode there. Besides entities, also we want to represent properties and property relations. So there are hierarchies of properties, there are inverse properties. There is symmetry or antisymmetry. There is reflexivity or irreflexivity. So a node can be, of course, connected to itself or does not have to be connected to itself. There are functional properties, inverse functionality, transitivity. And then we are dealing, besides entities, also with literals. And they can be, of course, of multimodal type, which means they can be text, they can be numbers, they can be images. And if you have numbers, for example, numbers with units, they follow their own semantics. And also this has to be somehow put into the system. And this is ongoing research, how to do this in a perfect way. So people are trying to do this and come up with, let's say, perfect representations of that. Okay, how do knowledge graph embeddings usually work? So that's a basic, let's say, workflow, how you compute them. You start out, this is number one here, with a typical knowledge graph. So you need something like a lookup layer where you are able to access, you know, each single node and its neighborhood. And what you do then there in the scoring layer of your system, you try to score every triple that you find. And a triple gets a high score, you know, if there are high chances for the triple to be true. And of course, you can do this by template knowledge graphs that are fed into the system to create these kind of embeddings. So they receive a triple receives a high score, even then if the only then if the chances are high that of course this fact, this triple is true. Again, also to learn this, we need a loss function, like we did this also when we did word embeddings. And this log function works in the way that, you know, you have to pay a penalty if, you know, your score function of a positive triple is less than the score of a synthetic negative triple, which means you need negative triples there to say, okay, there the likelihood that this is true is much higher than for another triple. So how do I generate negative triples? So because in a knowledge graph, everything you find there is true, there are no negative triples, we have to create them artificially. There, that so-called local closed world assumption holds, which means, okay, I can simply create corrupted versions of the triples. I substitute here parts of the triple with other things. And by that, of course, the chances are rather high that I create a negative triple. So this is how I create negative triples. I create corrupted versions of existing triples as my negative triples here. And then there are, of course, many ways to create with that then some kind of embedding, some kind of vector, and then you have to evaluate your vectors with specific downstream tasks. And one of these nice downstream tasks that you need or that you do with evaluating the quality of your embeddings is you do link prediction or graph completion. This means how well does exactly your model reflect the reality within the graph. However, this is a first slide to show you what kind of, let's say, knowledge graph embeddings are popular right now. So this is ongoing research, so there might be more possibilities next year or the year after next year. So there are an entire circus of so-called translational models. There are models based on semantic matching. There are so-called graph convolutional networks. And also there are relation paths dependent models. And even more. So you don't have to keep this in memory, only to show you that there are many different ways to create them. The last thing I want to point out here is the downstream task with which you evaluate your model. And this is usually called knowledge graph completion. And there are several tasks in link prediction that we are going to talk about. So there is, for example, triple classification. This is the task you present your model a triple, and then the model decides whether this triple, of course, is true or not. This is triple classification, so whether this exists or not, or whether this potentially, so you can also imagine a triple that is not in your knowledge graph, and then you get also a probability whether this triple might be true or not. And this, of course, is very nice for completion tasks, because, you know, knowledge graphs usually are far from complete. You don't know every fact about every entity, so there are, you know, things missing. And with knowledge graph completion, it can exactly close these gaps, which is nice. You can do precisely tail prediction, which means you give the system a subject and a predicate, and then you ask what's the object. So like, for example, you give the system the triple Joseph Fourier and occupation, and you don't know the object. And of course, the result would say, if you have a good model, that your occupation of Joseph Fourier is physicist, and probably with the second highest probability, chemist. And then there is also head prediction, where it's exactly the same game, but you have here to predict the head, which means the subject, and you have given the predicate property and the object. So for example, if you have who has the occupation physicist, then most likely the most probable answer would be Albert Einstein. But of course, there are more people who have the occupation physicist. Relation prediction means you present the system a subject and an object, and you have to predict the relation between them. So what's the predicate? If you then use, for example, Joseph Fourier as a subject and physicist as an object, the most likely thing that the system should predict would be occupation, because Joseph Fourier was a physicist, so his occupation was being a physicist. And then there is also entity classification, also referred to as type prediction, as a special subtask of limit prediction, because there you only look at a specific property, and the specific property is usually ISA, which means RDF type. You are looking for, you have some subject, you have then RDF type, and you want to know what type it is. And for that, this is then type prediction for Joseph Fourier, you would have to find out that this guy is of type person or of type human, for example. So these are then methods how you could evaluate your graph embedding model. Okay, and with that we have come to an end of this brief and rather high level introduction to machine learning. So if you are interested in machine learning, and I hope you are, then of course you have to deepen your knowledge in further courses and reading books and trying out here notebooks and stuff like that and doing experiments on your own, because machine learning really is a rather interesting, highly interesting, and nowadays also rather popular subject. So we did lots of things there, as you know. What is going to come now in the last part of the section? The last part of the section is entitled with ISE application. You remember ISE was the title of our lecture. It means information service engineering. And here we are going to put together all single things we have learned so far. We will put together natural language processing. We will put together knowledge graphs and machine learning to do them some, let's say, data science, to create applications for innovative innovation systems. You will see that we will do data visualization, we will do data analysis, we will do semantic search, we will do recommender systems. All of this stuff, of course, is applications of information service engineering, and I hope you will also then join the last section of this lecture.